Because what we say today is this: God has redeemed you and me and made it possible for us to live forever. And the answer I suggest to you, do you believe that? Do you believe that you are made for immortality and eternal life? Or is your concern only in this world? You know, all the ramifications of what that means. What am I going to eat for breakfast? What is my relationship? What is my work? All those kinds of, they're all legitimate. I want you to understand that. They're legitimate. But they're not a complete explanation of who and what you and I are. And that is today's feast. And I think the great joy of our Catholic faith, notice the word I use, how often I use the word Christian. When it comes to Our Lady, not too many of us appreciate her role in redemption as we do as Catholics. For us, she is the Mother of God. And the reason why we say that, and now I'm going to touch on a little bit on the explanation of our faith, is because that in Christ, there are two natures, human and divine, and through the human he saves us, and through the divine he saves us, but he also has only one person, the second person of the Blessed Trinity. And what that means practically, and this boggles our mind, you know, this is very hard to explain in a human way, and that is that Mary really is the Mother of God. There is no if, ands, or buts about it. She is the Mother of God because she is also the Mother of the person. Try and figure that out. You can't. And in so much of our faith, that's why when I first made my remark, you know, it wasn't just trying to give some difficulty, but to challenge you. We are in faith when we approach the awesome mystery of God. There is no way to get away from it. And even in our understanding of this world in which we live, the world that is mine and yours is the world of the senses. What we can see, you know, the visible, in other words, that's what we use, the word visible. What we can see and taste and touch and smell. And let's go a little further than that. What we can know technologically, what we can know scientifically, what we can imagine through these great development telescopes, seeing things millions of miles away. That's all creation. And you and I see that creation in the mystery of faith in the love of God. If you notice very carefully in the first two readings today, we ask God to bless us, first of all, in the Old Testament, in the great Moses, when he says, because God has revealed himself. Remember, you and I belong to the Judeo-Christian revelation. That simply means God loves us and has spoken to us for 3,000 years. Literally. First in the Old Testament, for 2,000 approximately, and for the last two, it would be really four, I guess, I'm not counting so well, in the mystery of the church. And therefore, the first blessing we have is God cares about you and me. The second blessing we have from the epistle to the Galatians is even more wonderful. God enters human history. God enters human history. Personally. No game playing. No some angel. God himself. And that boggles the imagination. That's why I say to you, we have to have faith. There is no way to know this awesome mystery except through faith. And then once having said that, then all the marvelous things of our faith comes to play. The feast that we celebrate today, the Mother of God, in one of the early councils of the church, they use the word Theopatos. That's the Greek word that means Mother of God. They define it. They said, you have to believe it. Mary is the Mother of God. As difficult and as hard as that is for you to understand. And when you push that point a little bit further, because of the human condition, and that you and I are so orientated to think think in terms of physiology and visibility, she is both mother and virgin. Whoa, you gotta be kidding. No, we're not kidding. We're saying that this is our faith. And just as it is very hard for us to understand the awesome mystery of God, I'll go a step further. It is also difficult for us to understand the divine plan and the economy of salvation. God doesn't save us your way and mine. He saves us his way. Because I think if we and I were honest, what would the first natural tendency for us to be? No more sickness, no more suffering, no more storms, no more tsunamis, no more hurricanes, no more, you know, all that stuff. And the reality is God does things his way. And the way that God has done it, and we always, whenever we speak of Christmas, and we speak of the wonderful mystery of Christ coming to the world, we always have the shadow of the cross. And the reason for that is because in the economy of salvation, God saved you and me in becoming one of us, but by his passion, death, and resurrection. That's how come you and I have hope of the resurrection. Not by our own power. The world in which we live means we're going to get old, we're going to get sick, we're going to kick the bucket. It is the grace and power of Jesus Christ who rose from the dead that will make you and me immortal and everlasting. That's why, for example, what God has done through the mystery of the church is make what is visible lead us to the invisibility. So that, for example, when we look at the sacraments, we see in the back of the church when the Eucharist will be, well, first it will be just bread, flour, and water, and the wine. That will become the body and blood of Christ. How? Does our eyes see it? Does our taste understand? No. It's the same, you know, whether you eat before it. But the awesome reality of our faith, that does invite us to the mystery of God. That's when we begin to understand the sacraments. The same thing with the candles, the sign that Jesus is the light of the world. Or if we look around and see some of the statues of some of the saints, what are we saying when we say there are saints? People like ourselves have lived holy lives in different times and eras, and are now with the Lord. As simple as all that. That's what you and I hope for. That we too, by God's grace and God's invitation, will be with the Lord. So, you know, I think when we see things in that fashion, the great mystery of the motherhood of Mary is a great, great Catholic doctrine. Let's put it that way. Okay? And what it means is simply this. God has blessed our flesh through the mystery of Jesus becoming one of us through Mary, his mother, who gave his birth. And from that, by the way, parenthetically, comes all the other mysteries of our Blessed Mother. The Immaculate Conception, Assumption, all the other mysteries flow from the fact that she is the Mother of God. And once again, what it suggests to us is this. So frequently when I speak to you, especially when you live a lot of years like I have, we cannot deny our humanity. There are so many human things that we need, you know, in the routine of everyday living. And what is the challenge that you and I have? We have to go, and I love this expression from the great Cardinal Jean-Abou Dalou, who said, we have to go from the shadows to the reality. The shadows, surprisingly enough, are flesh and blood. What we can see and taste and touch. Reality, God himself. That's why we speak of words like reflection. That's why we speak like words pray. And notice that we always pray through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
In other words, you and I can't even pray without Jesus. We cannot even pray without making up our own crazy ideas like paganism. The only way we can truly pray to God is through Jesus. And he gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit. And how was all this made possible? By the creature named our Blessed Mother, who accepted the will of God and the divine plan. Let it be done unto me according to your will. That's how your salvation of mine has become possible in the divine Trinity and economy of salvation. You know what that means? It's courage for you and for me. This lifts up our hope. Yes, we have problems and difficulties in humanity. We recognize our humanity. We recognize our fear. We recognize the fact that we can get sick and die, but yet we have hope and trust that we're going to live forever in Christ Jesus through the power of his resurrection. And Mary, our Blessed Mother, shows us how. And then what is ultimately the challenge that you and I have in this living out the redemption? What is the challenge that you and I have on this great feast, the octave day of Christmas and the solemnity of the Mother of God? To live in peace and joy. Oh boy, that's where the $64 question is. How do you live in peace and harmony? I mean, we get so annoyed in one another. I always like to give examples of myself because it makes it just shows you how human we are. I go on a line and I have to wait long and I get annoyed because people are stupid. They don't know how to, you know, go and do things they're supposed to do. They're spending to take out money to pay a bill. You're making everybody else wait, stupid. You know, all this kind of thing. So charity is always a challenge for us. And why? We're not for others. We're zeroing in on myself. What's for me? What makes it comfortable for me? For my limited appreciation of what life is. We don't open ourselves to the vastness of the infinity of God. Having said that, I'm going to make one final remark. So frequently we say to ourselves, what is it like to spend an eternity with God? And to use the beautiful expression of my teenage boy some 45 years ago, don't you get bored? Not when you deal with the infinity of God. Not when you deal with the infinity and majestic character of God. God is infinite. You and I are limited. We find it hard to go beyond our universe. I just spent 5 or 10 minutes talking to you about going from the visible to the invisible. Oh boy, we find that hard. Huh? Unless there's some concrete evidence, I don't want to believe it.